Sure how warm it was going to be today, so I dressed kind of light, and I can feel the wind, the cold wind seeping into different areas. Close down some of these. Zippers. It's supposed to be 70 today, which is crazy. It's, I think, the 9th of February, something like that. Currently at 64, so I'm going to ride up around Whitmire, South Carolina. There's the Sumter National Forest up here, and there's like thousands and thousands and thousands of acres. And there's WMA land here for hunting. There's the Ennery off-road vehicle park up here. It's closed until March for the winter. So I built a route in OnX off-road maps, and I'm running an old Android phone that doesn't have any cell service, but I downloaded the route before I left, and of course you can download all the base maps. And so I'm able to, with this old phone, follow my route, and works really well. So if it falls off the bike or whatnot, it's not the end of the world, because it isn't an active phone, or a phone with an active cell plan. This Amazon mount that I have, it's pretty good. Holds the phone nice and securely, spring-loaded, and it's got a rubber base, and then of course I have the phone in a rubberized protector anyway. So great trail system. I think it's like 28 to 32 miles of trails, something like that, if you were to add up all of them. And they've got all different skill levels, and it's only, I think, $5, or you can get a season pass. So really, it's a good deal. So I've got a new rear tire on this bike as well. It's the Tusk D Sport. This is the second trip on it. So far I really like it. I had a Kendra Trackmaster tire on it before, and was only able to get about just under 2,000 miles of life out of it before it had to be changed, and most of that was gravel or trails. I'd say maybe 80% gravel and trails and 20% road. I don't know. I was hoping for a little bit better life. So this Tusk D Sport, I think most people are saying they're getting between 3,500 and 4,000 miles. So that would be really nice. But I like this route. It is mainly all gravel, which is where I like to spend my time. So the bike I'm riding is a 2005 DRZ 400E, which, for those of you that are familiar with the DRZs, they actually made four models of these throughout the years. The K, the Kicker, the E, the S, and the SM. And only the S and the SM are street legal from Suzuki, here in the States anyway, and they've stopped production. Well, I shouldn't say that. They have stopped selling the E and the K in the US. They stopped the E in 2007. I'm not sure when they stopped the K. If anybody knows, post that up in the comments. So the main differences between the E and the S and the SM, and you can include the kicker in that, but is the E has a plastic tank from the factory, whereas the S and the SM have a metal tank. The E does not have the larger rear subframe that the S and the SM have. There's no passenger pegs. And then the E and the K have a different compression head, different cams, which also requires higher octane fuel, 91 or better. And most notably, the E and the K come with the FCR39 pumper carb. And that carb is a very popular mod to put on to the S and the SM. Really just changes that, the whole ride of the bike, whole power delivery and everything. If I had an S, and I did for a while, or we're gonna hang on to it, I would definitely put an FCR carb in. To make the E street legal, I added the rear subframe, so I was able to carry luggage racks. I kept all of the performance features of the E, for obvious reasons. And then I installed a different headlight. The E headlight that comes with it is just a single filament, single beam. So I wanted a high beam, low beam. I ended up putting in a Polysport Halo LED headlamp into my original E fairing, and that was actually surprisingly easy. It fits right in, and then along with all of the switch and the wiring and the LED turn signals and all that, I'm now street legal. One of the other differences between the K and the E and the S and the SM, wow, look at that. It's like a nuclear bomb went off. Is the gearing. So the E and I believe the K come with a 14 tooth front sprocket and a 47 tooth rear sprocket, whereas the S comes with a 15 tooth front sprocket and a 44 rear sprocket, and then the SM is something different altogether, and I don't remember what it is. So on this E, I put the 15-44 gearing on it, and I think that gearing combined with the power differences of the E and the lighter weight aspects of the bike, like that for me is the perfect combination. I can take all these bags off and I can do single track trails. I can load it up with 70 pounds of camping gear and do multiple day adventure rides. I can go out and just do easy rides like today. And I've never felt wanting for more power. I think that's a fantastic, I just smeared a bug right on my visor. I think that's a fantastic combination. So what I like to do is multi-day adventure rides on this bike, and so I've got a couple of added pieces of equipment that help with that. Additionally, with my size and weight as well, I'm 6'4", 215 pounds, and so I've redone the suspension on this bike, not only to handle my weight, but also to handle the weight of camping gear on an adventure ride and whatnot. And then as you can see, I've got Pro Taper tall adventure bars, so I'm able to stand up a little bit more comfortably and still reach the bars. Still have plenty of room for all the items on the bike that I need up at, you know, kind of at the handlebar level. You'll see I have a Voyager. It's not the Pro, it's just the Voyager by Trail Tech. It's got very simplistic base maps. I don't use it for navigation, I use the OnX, which is much more robust. I also have a seat concept seat on this bike, which is awesome. I can't recommend that enough to anybody with the DRZ. The stock seat is to me, very uncomfortable, and I used to have to wear like cyclist shorts just to try to get some added comfort. But since getting this seat comfort seat, it has been night and day different. I've said this before, what's interesting about it is when I first put it on and sat down on it, you know, I thought to myself, okay, I mean, it's not as comfortable as I thought it would be. It's comfortable, but I was expecting just this plush, super comfy seat. And it's not a negative, it's not a hit on the seat. I just didn't understand it. And what was notable is, like at the mid part of the ride, or even towards the end of the first day, or any time during the days thereafter, I never thought to myself, like, man, this seat's uncomfortable. It never got worse. It was the same comfort all day long, which was really nice. I don't think you could go wrong with a seat concept seat. And I'll always have one on any DRZ I have. Part of what takes so long is they solicit information from you about your size and weight and the type of riding that you're gonna do, and they build the seat per those specs. So it, you know, like, I'm not opposed to buying a used one, but it wouldn't be, I don't think, quite as ideal as a seat that they made for me. So getting back to the tires, my front tire is still a Trackmaster. I've tried the D-Sport front tire and I don't like it, especially on river crossings. It just does not want to track well. It seems to just hunt all the time. And to some extent, on surfaces like this, it's a little bit of the same. So I stayed with the Trackmaster. I'm happy with that combination. I've never tried the Continental or a couple of the other, I think there's a Pirelli maybe that's recommended for the front. But you can't beat the Trackmaster's price. Now that I've been riding for about 10 miles or so, I'm gonna check the bags just to be sure. Everything looks good. Nothing seems to be loosened up. Yep. So, very happy with the bags. They're, I had Nelson Rig saddlebags. They were 27 liters per side. And, they were good. They stuck out a little bit more than these. Pros and cons to both, I suppose. I like the looks of these better. And not everything is about looks, of course, but these are supposed to be 25 liters per side. But there was a couple key reasons I got this. These bags is, one, they're easier to take on and off. So if I do ride trails and I want the saddlebags on the side, I can take them off. The second notable thing, car coming. The second notable thing is they're, I don't know if modular is the right word, but you can put a lot of smaller bags and different bags through the MOLLE system on the outside. So each bag has MOLLE on the front and the rear. For different bags, for bottle holders or smaller bags, and I really like that. Just like gear management has always been something that I've, I didn't know there was a gate down here. Am I off the map? Yeah, I'm off the, I took an unnecessary turn. Any rate, I didn't have any MOLLE attachments on the Nelson Rig saddlebags that I had, I believe they do make a Hurricane model by Nelson Rig that does have some Molly, but that's not the one I had. So I like that. The downside is the Tusk Highland X2 bags are not waterproof on their own. You have to have a dry bag insert on the inside. So that makes packing them a little bit more challenging, at least for me. And then the way that the bags are contoured, the opening at the top is not as wide as the rest of the bag throughout. So it's almost like you have a stuff sack and you haven't opened up the drawstring of the stuff sack all the way, and so you're kind of fighting that a little bit, putting bags down in. It has the beaver tail on the top back, which I really like. And so you unclip the beaver tail, fold it open, put your bag on top, and wrap the beaver tail around it and close your clips again. That part I really like. That is super convenient. Oh boy. Alright, I was worried they were going to come out of the yard, but they didn't. God. There are some dogs on this route. That's not one of the places that I've been worried about in the past. But up here, in a little bit, there are some dogs that will come out. I was watching an interesting video on how to deal with dogs, and I always thought, well, yeah, I know how to deal with them. Just accelerate past. And what this YouTuber was advocating was, you know, slow down, make them change their point of interception, and then as they lock onto that new point, that's where you apply throttle and go past them. So, might have the opportunity to try that here in a little bit. So, just another short little hardball connector. Turning down Little North Carolina Road. And there were some dogs here on the house coming up here on the left, but I haven't seen them in a while, so we'll see what happens today. Oh, hey pups. Don't judge a book by its cover, I suppose. Those dogs were cool. Right up here, it was high, super high the other day. See what it's like today. Oh yeah, can actually see the road. It was, all of this was completely underwater. I think starting right in here. Okay, knowing now what this looked like, I could have made it through. Yeah, here we go. Tempted to stop here for lunch, but all the bamboo. All right, had a little lunch break. Get back to some riding. So another little hop on the hardball here for a second. This is another house with a dog. Dogs. So we'll see what comes out here. Last time they came right across the field out on me. Yep. Well, I'm way ahead. That dog chose a poor interception route. He was way behind me. And I don't think he quite had the legs for it either. Hate to see all that dumping. You know, that trailer just a little while ago and old camper. And all this trash. I wish people wouldn't do that. Just take it to the dump. Have pride in your home area or just in the area. Like, why do you have to throw a cooler away down on the creek? Just, now maybe that fell out of the back of somebody's truck and light moves favorable. But I kind of feel that that was dumped on purpose. At least that, I think that was turkey. Yeah, I got a photo of my bike right here before. Memorial something, 45 acres dedicated to the South Carolina Federation of Women's Clubs. Pennies or Pines project.
So after seeing this sign, I was kind of curious, so I looked it up on the internet and I found the website for the South Carolina General Federation of Women's Clubs. And this section of woods was dedicated as part of the creation of a Pennies for Pines dedicated to past SCFWC presidents. And here it was, located in the National Forest. So it's pretty cool.
Currently on Jack Wilson Road. They say South Carolina roads aren't maintained well. Okay, back on gravel. Oh boy. That was unexpected. I've always wondered what this was here. Erected by the Newberry County, post number 24, American Legion, memory of the following men in the United States Air Force who lost their lives as a result of a plane crash near this spot on February 5th, 1943.
So I found out the story behind this airplane crash. It was actually two aircraft, two B-25s in 1943, and they ran into one another and both crashed in a farmer's field. And so I think it was 14 or so casualties. One of the aircrafts had taken off out of Tampa, Florida, and was en route to Greenville. So tragic story.
Curious what this is.
for years. Oh, wow. Huh. A well? No. I don't have a clue what that is.
Does it for this video. I appreciate everybody tuning in. I hope you enjoy watching this content as much as I enjoy making it. So please give me some feedback in the comment section. And if you like this content and want to see more of it, please like and subscribe. Thanks very much.